Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of A Garden in Paris by Stephanie Grace Whitson. Narrated by Alexandra Okarma. Recorded Books Inspirational is an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. This book is copyrighted 2005 by Stephanie Grace Whitson. This recording is copyrighted 2005 by Recorded Books. After 2 years of widowhood, Mary Davis discovers a framed motto at an antique market. It offers her a ray of hope and the promise of release from her private struggles with untold secrets and regrets. In a rare act of independence, Mary follows her heart to Paris. Perhaps it is here that she will find a way to reconcile her past and face the future with honesty. And now, A Garden in Paris.
Prologue. November 2003. Omaha, Nebraska. The only problem with her life, Mary thought, was that she didn't have one. Sam had been gone for 2 years, but she was still playing by his rules. The weight of the charade was too much. She would take the pills. The nurse and the sheriff had accounted for every prescription medication the day Sam died. They'd taken the OxyContin and hundreds of dollars worth of other pharmaceuticals off to be destroyed. Except for the sleeping pills. The hospice nurse had trusted Mary with those, had even urged her to make use of them until she could see her own doctor. Had she looked in the bottle, the nurse would have had second thoughts. Mary had been collecting pills for a long time. She knew enough about computers to ask Jeeves and follow a few links until she was convinced, even taking into account reduced potency, that she had enough to do the trick painlessly. She hadn't expected her hand to tremble so when she opened the bottle. She hadn't expected to spill the water from the glass on her bedside table. As the water trickled across the tabletop and dripped onto the sculptured carpet below, Mary pondered the realization that, while she wanted to think she was the kind of person St. Peter would be glad to see in line at the pearly gates, when it came right down to it, she had no real assurance as to what might be on the other side of what Sam had irreverently called the dirt nap. She put the lid back on the bottle of pills, tucked it under the bank of pillows propped up against the headboard, and leaned back. Staring up at the ceiling, she scolded herself. Mary Elizabeth McKibben Davis, you're 50 years old. You have no life of your own, no future plans, and no guts to do anything about it. No wonder Sam spelled Elizabeth with a Z instead of an S. No wonder he named your daughter after his mother. Elizabeth Davis had a spine. Mary Elizabeth McKibben has none. Elizabeth Davis went to market. Mary Elizabeth McKibben stayed home. She fell asleep, repeating her bittersweet version of the old nursery rhyme. By the next evening, Mary was grateful she had put the pills away. Earlier that afternoon, she had wandered into a store and found a cheap little piece of junk with a motto that offered hope. She couldn't get it out of her mind. And then there was that magazine cover, featuring the sea cloud slicing through the water, her sails unfurled against a brilliant blue sky. Reading the article, Mary had learned that the ship's home port was a small town in southern France called Arcachon. Her heart pounded as she reread the article, searching for the captain's name. Instead of taking the pills, she wrote a letter. Chapter 1. November 30th, 2003. Dear Jean-Marc, if this letter reaches you, it will be a miracle of the God whose existence you denied all those years ago. It's been a long time since that evening when Sam took the microphone away from the bandleader and surprised everyone by announcing our engagement. You were standing by the door, looking at our table across the crowded dining room. I'll never forget the look you gave me just before you turned to go. It was nearly 30 years ago. It was yesterday. I went to your hotel the next day, but you were gone. I have a grown daughter. My hair is short now, and I have given up both trying to tame the curls and cover the gray. If we were to pass on the street, you might walk right by and never know it was me. Do you still play Chopin? Did you spend that summer sailing around the Mediterranean? I thought of you often, even though I did not keep my promise to come with you. Do you remember the first day you took me sailing? When we anchored for lunch, you tore off a chunk of the baguette your mother had packed in that old basket and spread brie on it. You insisted eating something would make me feel better. And you were right. The seasickness receded. I still love brie. It will be Christmas soon, and I've decided to return to Paris. My daughter might be with me. Sam will not. He always said he would die first, and unlike me, Sam always kept his promises. I suppose this ridiculous letter is a sign that I'm growing old. They say old people are prone to try to relive the past, and they forget things. The other day, I couldn't remember my own phone number. But after all this time, I still remember your address. I used to try to imagine you aboard the Sea Cloud. And now I've seen the article in Seafaring Magazine and learned that your dream came true. She is yours. When I have thought about you over the years, I have also imagined you married to that lovely chanteuse who flirted with you so mercilessly when you and I were together. You seemed to find her annoying, but she was devoted to you. And I have hoped that, perhaps, you finally allowed her to see the man I knew. I've even let myself picture you with children and grandchildren. A man who can tell stories like you should definitely have grandchildren. But the article makes no mention of a family, just a humorous quote from you about the Sea Cloud being your best wife yet. I don't know all the reasons I feel compelled to put this in the mail. I suppose I am hoping that somehow you will let me know that you have forgiven me. My life has not been all broken promises. I'll be thinking of you, Christmas Eve in Paris. If you think of me, picture me. Well, you know where I'll be. She had been writing furiously, but when it came to signing the note that had suddenly become a letter, Mary hesitated, leaning her head against the wing of the chair she used at her desk. The sun was beginning to nudge towards the horizon, streaking the sky with pink and orange, and backlighting the stand of trees beyond Sam's garden. Mary laid the pen down to watch the sunrise through the great bay window opposite her desk. As the sky brightened, she absent-mindedly smoothed the frayed edge of the old silk robe she'd put on in the pre-dawn dark. Sam had always hated the color, which approximated the muddy creek water flowing through the southern end of their property. The smoothness of the silk accented the fact that she had yet to dip into the jar of hand lotion this morning. Dry skin. Another harbinger of aging. Another regret. She reread the letter, still not certain how to sign it. Your friend? Hardly an accurate description of either their relationship or their parting. Love? Too cavalier. Sincerely. Too formal. When she leaned forward, putting her elbows on the writing desk so she could rest her chin on her folded hands, the robe's wide sleeve fell back, its frayed edge tickling her arm. Sam had urged her to throw it away long ago.
You look like one of those homeless women who goes picking through the piles at the Salvation Army, he had complained the first time she grabbed it out of a pile off the dressing room floor.
It's comfortable, she had grumbled. Why can't I be comfortable in my own house? Sam had come up behind her and put his arms around her, resting his chin on the top of her head and staring at her in the mirror.
The house staff will never respect you if you bumble about in that.
He had her yellow silk dressing gown over his arm. He held it out.
This is what the lady of the manor should wear.
With his free hand, he traced her jawline and let his hand play down the lapel of the mud-colored robe. He nuzzled her ear.
Would Madame care to change?
Funny how memories like that came more often lately. That little incident had happened on their first morning back from their honeymoon, although Sam had always reminded her to call it their wedding trip. On that long-ago morning, the young bride, Mary Elizabeth McKibben Davis, had pulled the old robe off and donned the new without any more argument. Looking down at it now, she fingered the worn silk, realizing just how symbolic of the rest of her life that incident would be. She had had to change garments a lot in the past 30 years. Sighing, Mary reached out to pick up the framed motto sitting beside the lamp. Running her finger along its scratched metal frame, she mouthed the words, "It is never too late to be what you might have been." She'd picked it up the day before in a shop down in the old market district. It was the kind of place Sam despised and Mary was drawn to. A musty collection of high-ceilinged rooms, boasting shelves crowded with bric-a-brac and racks of old curtains and clothing creatively tagged vintage. Mary turned the frame over, smiling when she realized the piece of masking tape, pricing it at 50 cents, was still affixed to the back. It was the only thing she'd bought in her ramblings yesterday, a day she was supposed to be at the stationer's, ordering invitations for Elizabeth and Jeffrey's wedding breakfast. She would have to do that today. Even if the wedding wasn't until next May, Liz was already fretting. If Mary thought about it, her daughter's apprehension hurt her feelings. Liz seemed convinced that with her father gone, everything would fall apart, including her wedding plans. As if it had been Sam who kept track of things all these years. The red rim of the sun peeked over the distant hills, and crimson light flooded the room. Mary placed the motto back beside her Tiffany desk lamp, remembering how Sam had complained when she insisted the desk be placed opposite the great bay window.
"It will distract you from your work," he had said. "No one puts their desk in front of a window like that."
"I do," Mary had insisted. "I want to see outside." Sam had relented about the placement of her desk. He had stood his ground, though, when it came to the subject of work. His definition of the word was as far removed from Mary's as the English estate in his family history was from the Irish shanty in hers. Mary soon realized that what Samuel Davis called her work would have made her father shake his head in disgust. But then Michael McKibben had only the money in his pockets and no experience with managing funds earned by the previous generation.
sitting at a desk, answering invitations to charity functions, would never qualify as work to a McKibben. And although Mary had done it for over a quarter of a century, she'd never really considered it work either. Thank God Elizabeth did all that now. At last, Mary was free to do what she wanted. If only she could find what it was she wanted to do. She looked down at the letter, running her finger over his name. Monsieur Jean-Marc David. Three first names. She'd teased him about that. As the light turned golden in the room, Mary snatched up the old ballpoint pen she had dug out of her desk drawer and signed the letter. Fondly, Mary. She could still hear Jean-Marc's voice whispering her name with that gorgeous bass voice of his. It had taken her 3 years of practice, but she thought she knew how to pronounce a proper French R. But when Jean-Marc said her name, she realized she had it all wrong. It wasn't trilled, and it wasn't pulled to the back of the throat the way the Germans did it. It was, well, when Jean-Marc said it as part of her name, it was beautiful. Her hand trembled as she addressed the envelope. This will end up in the bottom of some mailbag in Arcachon. The neighborhood is probably a parking lot by now. That's what they do in resort towns. They build up and take out the old neighborhoods. With their view of the bay, the Davids probably sold out long ago. Even if they didn't, if Jean-Marc went to sea as planned, he would have sold the house as soon as his parents died. And surely they are dead by now. Mary stood up. Walking around the desk, she went to the wall of leaded windows and climbed onto the upholstered cushion in the bay. She grabbed a pillow and hugged it to herself. Down past a low hedge, the sun was illuminating the tops of the 100-year-old pine trees that served as a boundary between the groomed lawn and the prairie beyond. Several of the pines hosted decades-old bittersweet vines that wound up their trunks and provided garlands laden with orange berries for the five mantles in the house every fall. In the morning light, the berries shone bright, and Mary realized the first frost had come and gone, and no one had harvested the bittersweet. Just as well. Had anyone mentioned it, Cecil Baxter would have forced his arthritic knees to climb one more year, and Cecil was far too old to be climbing trees. She was going to have to hire help before next spring, and would need to think long and hard about how to bring that up without hurting Cecil's feelings. Stretching again, Mary stood up and went to the opposite side of the room and into the half-empty dressing room. She had never managed to care enough about clothing to fill all the hanging space, much less the shelves and drawers. "You all right, ma'am?" A soft knock on the bedroom's double doors accompanied the low voice. "Just moving a little slow this morning, Irene. Come on in." She opened the lingerie drawer, but then hastily retreated to her desk to get the envelope and tuck it into her robe pocket, while Irene set a breakfast tray on the bench at the foot of the bed. The older woman's eyebrows drew together. "You're not coming down with anything, I hope. Holidays coming and all?" Mary nodded toward the broad expanse of windows. "Gorgeous morning." She turned away and headed back toward the dressing room, calling over her shoulder. "I'm driving into town this morning. I'll likely pick up something for lunch at Val's." After pulling on faded jeans, she slipped her bare feet into a pair of beaded moccasins before yanking a sweater out of her drawer. Irene's voice at the door behind her made her jump. "How much weight have you lost?"
£38, Mary answered, as she pulled the sweater over her head. And 10 more to go. She turned around and patted her stomach. Not bad for an old gal, huh? She reached for an ivory linen blazer. Can I get you anything in town? Irene shook her head. Have Val make you one of her malts. Put some meat back on those bones. Mary chuckled. Don't worry, old friend. I'm not exactly wasting away. Once again turning her back, she grabbed a leather clutch off a shelf and quickly transferred the envelope out of the robe pocket and into her purse. She squinted and peered into the full-length mirror. Lifting her glasses, she pursed her lips, frowning slightly. Those two lines at the corners of her mouth were getting more pronounced by the day. Maybe some wrinkle cream. Maybe Botox. Meredith at the club went for regular injections and swore by her doctor. And she did look a little younger. Irene cleared her throat. You going to the post office? Mary straightened up. Why? Saw you tuck a letter into your purse. Irene nodded toward the leather pouch. If you're going to the post office, I'd appreciate it if you could get a roll of stamps. Of course. Mary brushed by her. Don't forget, I won't be home for lunch. She hurried into the bedroom and stopped by the breakfast tray long enough to take a gulp of coffee. Bye. Mary paused. And thanks again for the help with the dinner party last night. She rested her hand on the doorknob. I don't think I've ever told you, Irene, how much you've meant to me. You've saved me from many a social nosedive over the years. Last night was no exception. Irene snorted and shook her head. No such thing. They would have understood. That's what you think. They would have pretended to understand. But I would have been the talk of the club today if you hadn't called and reminded me to get home. How could I have forgotten about dinner with the Goldenhirsches? Mary paused. I like Maud. Really? Well, it's likely she's forgotten a dinner or two in her day, Irene offered as she bent over to arrange the pillows on Mary's bed. And Elizabeth was here. It wouldn't have been a complete disaster. Well, maybe Maud would have let it go, but Elizabeth would have been mortified. I know she's counting on the Goldenhirsch's support for help with the new oncology wing. Irene straightened up. Elizabeth would have lived. It's not like she's never forgotten anything. And her own mother's birthday is a darn sight more important than dinner with rich friends. Now, Irene, Mary said, that was last year. She was under a lot of stress trying to run the business without Sam. And I did tell her I didn't want a fuss made over it. Well, then, Irene said, I guess you got your wish. Mary smiled. You know, you saved the day at my first dinner party, and you saved the day at the last. I owe you big time. I love you for all you've done. Now, goodbye. I can't handle standing here watching you make my bed. It's my job to make your bed, Mrs. Davis, Irene said. Mary paused at the door and looked back. If you sense an earthquake later this morning, it's my fault. I'm dropping in on the foundation board meeting. Irene's eyebrows shot up. Really? Mary nodded. Something, well, several somethings, actually, that Elizabeth said at dinner last night make me think it might be a good idea. That George Kincaid business, Irene said. Mary sighed. Sam wouldn't like it. I really don't want to get involved, but after arguing with myself half the morning, I've decided I owe it to him to fix it. Good luck, Irene said, plumping a pillow. Thanks. I'll need it. Mary flashed a smile and headed down the hall toward the back stairs. Back stairs. Sam had never wanted her to use them. That's the servants' entrance, he'd always said. The stairs were narrow and steep, and the walls had always been painted white. As she descended them this morning, Mary paused, looking down the flight of stairs toward the hardwood landing. Yellow. We'll paint the walls yellow. And hang some of those black and white photographs of Paris I saw at Target. She could almost hear Sam snorting his displeasure. All right, then. I'll buy a digital camera and take my own photographs. Irene lumbered toward the unmade bed, worrying over the George Kincaid business and grumbling about the untouched breakfast on Mary's tray. She smoothed the sheets and tucked the quilts in place, taking special care not to stress the fragile fabric on the top one. Mrs. Davis had hauled it home from an antique shop a month ago, exclaiming over the age of the chintz and the border fabric she called a pillar print, whatever that meant. She'd folded it at the bottom of her bed and said it was too fragile to really use, but she just wanted to enjoy it for a while before deciding where to display it. Finishing with the bed, Irene paused and looked out the windows, just in time to see the silver Austin Healey make its way down the winding drive and out onto the road. That was a good sign. Mrs. Davis hadn't driven that car much since the mister passed on, and she was going to a meeting down at the office, taking an interest. That was good, too. Maybe she'd turned a corner. Humming while she worked, Irene moved around the room, drawing the sheer blinds down on each set of windows in the bay, straightening the desktop, plucking a piece of thread off the carpet. When she grabbed the coffee cup Mary had set on her bedside table on her way out the door, her toe hit something and sent it rolling under the bed. With a grunt, Irene bent down to retrieve it. A bottle of pills lay on its side, barely hidden by the damask bed skirt. Irene reached for it, lifting her glasses and squinting at the label. Take 1 to 2 capsules by mouth at bedtime as needed for sleep. May cause drowsiness. Alcohol may intensify this effect. Use care when operating a car or dangerous machinery. Irene opened the bottle. It held a collection of pills. Different sizes, different colors. Lots and lots of pills. Enough to kill a horse, she thought. She slumped down onto the window seat and closed her eyes. Oh, Lord. No, Lord. Irene sat for a few minutes looking out the window. Her husband came into view, perched on the riding lawnmower, his spindly legs sticking out either side. He guided the mower along the edge of the perennial bed, then stopped beside the reflecting pool and got off. He looked toward the house. Looking for her, Irene knew. They were supposed to harvest the late elderberries growing along the back of those beds today, the ones Mrs. Davis had asked Cecil to try to save from frost. Irene looked down at the pills again. She stood up and dropped them into her apron pocket. Just when I thought she was coming back to life. Something she'd heard on Oprah came to mind. People did that sometimes. Set things in order. Just before they... Now stop that, Irene Baxter. That's nonsense. But was it? Was it really? Mrs. Davis and Elizabeth hadn't been getting along. Truth be told, Liz hardly ever came around these days. And what was that Mrs. Davis had said about last night? Something about it being her last dinner party? And why'd she suddenly decide to go to that stuffy foundation meeting anyway? George Kincaid. She wanted to set things straight about that. What, Irene wondered, would happen once that got straightened out? And what was in that letter Mrs. Davis was hiding in her purse anyway? Irene picked up the breakfast tray and headed for the hallway. At the bedroom door, she turned back around to survey the room, scolding herself for being so dramatic. Mrs. Davis was slowly taking back her life. Wasn't that quilt on the end of the bed a sure sign of that? She was learning about something new. And what about the lost weight? She was looking 10 years younger. And she was driving the Austin Healey again. Still arguing with herself, Irene headed to the back stairs. At the top of the stairs, she looked back toward the master suite. Morning light was streaming out into the hallway through the open doors. Too big for one lonely woman. Too big, Lord. The pill bottle in her apron pocket bumped against the handrail. At the sound of all those pills rattling around, Irene sighed. Help me know what to do. Chapter 2. Had anyone warned her about what would happen once she stepped through the massive Davis Enterprises boardroom doors, Mary Davis would likely have turned left instead of right when she got off the elevator, descended the stairs to the first floor, slipped out the back door into the narrow alley behind the old brick building, revved up the Austin Healey, and escaped. Never mind that she had spent nearly a quarter of a century perfecting the art of being someone she didn't know. Never mind she had learned to spend a great deal of her life in places she didn't like. Given a warning as to what would happen between her and Elizabeth, Mary would have avoided the meeting and raised the subject of an architect for the Samuel F. Davis Oncology Wing of Creighton University Hospital over dinner at Vivace, with Jeffrey Scott at the table to smooth his fiancée's ruffled feathers. But she had no warning. So Mary arrived early enough to schmooze and pretended she didn't notice how surprised the board members were at her presence. She asked Derek Miller how his son was doing at Creighton, inquired after Harvey Fagan's aging basset hound, and soothed Millie Patton's concerns over what to serve at the next foundation fundraiser. And then Elizabeth arrived. "Look who's here." Harvey Fagan put his arm around Mary's shoulders and squeezed before pulling out the leather chair at the head of the boardroom table for her. Grateful that Harvey's back was turned so he did not see Liz's silent appraisal of her mother's blue jeans and moccasin-clad feet, Mary slid into the upholstered armchair next to the chairman's. "I'm just listening in," she said. There was an edge to Liz's voice from the minute she called things to order. Mary wondered if Elizabeth and Jeff had had a spat. That was happening all too frequently these days. A broken engagement at this point would not only be a nightmare logistically, but also a mistake. Jeffrey James Scott was the best thing to happen to Elizabeth Davis in a very long time, and Mary hoped Liz knew it. "The string quartet has confirmed," Millie Patton was saying, "but their fee has gone up considerably since last year." Elizabeth frowned. "Gone up? How much?" "Well," Millie looked around the table, "several hundred dollars, actually. But you said you wanted them, so I went ahead." She paused. I suppose I should have called you. No, Elizabeth said, shaking her head. It's fine. A call would have been nice, but I meant for you to be in charge. She looked down at the meeting agenda and checked off one item. Watching her, Mary wondered at Liz's uncanny ability to be completely polite, and yet make it apparent that what she was feeling was exactly the opposite of what she was saying. In the boardroom, Elizabeth Davis was nearly a carbon copy of her father. Which was, Mary thought, not necessarily a good thing, either for the Volunteer Foundation members seated around the table this morning, or for Liz. Mary forced her attention back to the agenda. The group discussed several more items, and the longer the meeting went on, the more disgruntled Mary became at her daughter's systematic bullying of the committee. She did what she could to mediate and to soften the blows Elizabeth was landing. Well, Elizabeth said, laying aside the agenda, those items are taken care of. She picked up a slim file folder. But there's still the matter of an architect. She opened the file and pulled out a piece of paper. We reached a consensus, Harvey Fagan spoke up, looking around the table. Everyone smiled and nodded their agreement. I read that in the file, Elizabeth said, but I can't agree to it. The tension level in the room rose palpably. Mary sat up straighter. She looked around the table at the other committee members. Millie Patton's mouth was drawn down into a thin line that emphasized the fine wrinkles descending from the corners of her mouth to her chin. Derek Miller was fiddling with his pen, trying to avoid eye contact with anyone. He looked up only when Mary spoke. You and I both agreed to abide by the committee's findings, she said. Elizabeth shook her head. George Kincaid should never have been on that list. He's made himself the laughingstock of Omaha more than once, and choosing him for this project is... Compassionate, Mary said. The publicity will do him good. The Samuel Davis Foundation is not a rehab organization, Liz said. No one here said it should be, Mary replied. It is, however, named for a man who is one of George's best friends. She leaned toward the table and put her hands palms down on either side of the file before her. Your father would agree with the committee. And heaven knows George could use the good press doing this project will give him. Liz's left eyebrow arched slightly. Her nostrils flared. She stood up. Could I talk to you in my office, Mother? Mary laughed. I don't think there's a need for that, dear. Please. Liz left the room without a backward glance. Mary looked around the table. Millie was studying the meeting agenda, pretending to jot something down. Neither Derek nor Harvey met her gaze either. She took a deep breath. Listen, folks, we finished everything else. Millie, you've done fine work. When Millie looked up, Mary smiled warmly, adding, You did the right thing with the reception music. Thank you. She turned to the men. Derek, Harvey, she said, You two have a good round of golf later this afternoon, and greet your wives for me. She stood up. And thank you again for your selflessness on behalf of the Foundation. You've all spent a lot of hours working on this project when you could have been doing 1,000 other things. Someday I'll find a way to thank you. Mary patted Derek Miller's shoulder. You tell that boy of yours to come and talk to Liz next week about a summer internship. She headed for the door. The minute Mary closed Liz's office door behind her, Liz held up her hand. "It's my last one, promise." She put the cigarette out before turning to look out the expanse of windows behind her desk. Folding her arms across her torso, she waited. Tension showed in every line of her elegantly clad body, from her 2 feet, planted about a foot apart on the imported carpet, to her ramrod straight back and squared shoulders. "Would you mind telling me what is going on?" Mary slid into one of the leather club chairs in the seating area in the corner. "Well," she said, tracing the grain of the leather with her index finger as she spoke. "We are finalizing plans for a reception after the groundbreaking ceremony for the Samuel F. Davis wing at Creighton, and discussing the details." Liz wheeled around and faced her mother. "That's not what I meant, and you know it." "George?" Mary asked, looking up at her. "George Kincaid is a drunk," Liz blurted out, "and I will not have his name associated with this project. And I'd appreciate it if you would refrain from embarrassing me in front of the Foundation Committee that way. You haven't been to a meeting in ages, and to have you show up unannounced like that, and then treat me like a child was..." Liz drew in a breath. "It was inappropriate." Mary frowned. "It is never inappropriate to raise a voice of reason and kindness where none has been heard," she said. "And if you were embarrassed, I'm sorry. But I didn't do that to you. You did it to yourself when you held George's name up to ridicule." "I said nothing in that boardroom that isn't common knowledge," Liz snapped. "I was just the only one gutsy enough to say it." "Just because something is common knowledge doesn't mean it has to be aired publicly. The last thing George needs is another group of people ignoring the quality of his work and refusing to come alongside him when he needs it." "The quality of his work?" Liz snorted. "What work? What work has he done in the last 2 years? He's been locked up in detox." Mary leaned forward to rest her chin on her folded hands. She sighed before motioning to the other club chair. "Take a cleansing breath and sit down, Elizabeth. We're having a discussion, not a joust." Liz blinked a few times. She went to the chair Mary had pointed out, but instead of sitting down, she stood behind it, bracing her hands on the back. "As to your comment about my not coming to meetings, I don't think that's quite accurate," Mary said. "I've been at nearly every meeting I was told about." She paused, letting what she had not said, which was that Liz had had a number of meetings without Mary being informed, have its full effect before going on. "I've been charming and offered my opinions, most of which have been ignored. But I'm not mad, and I don't really know why you are. Have you and Jeffrey had an argument? You came into that meeting with a ginormous chip on your shoulder." Mary pronounced the word ginormous slowly, hoping the use of Jeff's favorite descriptive term would make Liz smile. Liz did not smile. Instead, she flung the word back at Mary. "If I have a ginormous chip on my shoulder, it's because I'm under a ginormous amount of pressure. And I don't see anyone coming alongside me to help. And now my own mother is siding with the committee and helping them make a huge mistake." "Well," Mary said, standing up, "if it turns out to be a mistake, I'll take full responsibility." Liz snorted. "Is that funny?" Liz shook her head. "Come on, Mother. You've never taken responsibility for anything in your life, except the flavor of the coffee and the freshness of the canapes at Daddy's soirees."
Mary sat back down. Hard. Her heart thumped. She inhaled sharply, as if recovering from being hit. She swallowed and fought back the tears that sprang to her eyes. "I'm sorry, Mother. That was..." Liz reached out to put her hand on her mother's shoulder. Mary waved her away, shaking her head. "I think," she finally managed to say, "I'll be going." She pushed herself out of the chair and headed for the door. "Mother, please," Liz said. Mary looked at her daughter, painfully aware of the anger in Liz's Nordic blue eyes, her father's eyes. She looked away, swallowed, and then looked back into those eyes. "I don't fault you for thinking you can ignore my opinions, dear. I've been walking around in a fog since your father died." She smiled. "But I'm waking up. And I'm going to have more to say about things in the coming days." She put her hand on the doorknob. "Now I'm going to grab my purse and my folder from the boardroom and scoot home. And you, Elizabeth, are going to call George Kincaid and congratulate him on winning the bid for the new wing. It's the right thing to do." Mary's next words were said slowly and with special emphasis. "And what's even more important, it's what your father would have wanted." When Liz opened her mouth to protest, Mary interrupted her. "That's the way it's going to be, Elizabeth. You can bully the committee, but you cannot bully me. Not anymore." As she walked down the hallway toward the boardroom, Mary passed by the lighted oil painting of Samuel Frederick Davis that hung just opposite the elevator doors. She paused to look into the deep blue eyes. "It's taken a long time, Sam, but I'm finally going to fight back. I hope it isn't too late." On her way home, Mary mailed the letter. Chapter 3. Liz. It took me until I was 18 years old to finally give myself permission not to love my mother. Don't get me wrong, I love my mother. But I don't love her. There's a difference the English language can't quite express. I don't know if there's a language anywhere that does. But I'd like to think that somewhere there's a family structure that allows for a daughter to respect and cherish her mother in the ideal sense, without loving her in the emotional sense. Maybe it's wrong to say I don't love her. Certainly I appreciate her giving me life and changing diapers and making my life easy. It's just that she and I have never connected. I've always been more like my father. He and I could share unspoken jokes across the dinner table that went right over my mother's head. When we watched a movie as a family, it was Daddy and I who laughed at the same scenes. Mother would politely join in, but more often than not, it was just that. She was only being polite. She really didn't think the campfire scene in Blazing Saddles was funny. Daddy and I practically rolled on the floor every time we watched it. I struggled all through high school to make a connection with Mother. She did everything all my friends' mothers did. She worked on committees and gave her share of parties. She was nice to my girlfriends and compassionate to the boys I dragged home and then summarily dumped one by one. She applauded my good grades and gave one of the most memorable graduation parties in our class. She even cried at the baccalaureate. But for all those happy memories, there isn't one moment of time when I can say she and I really connected. We've always been like two dancers, just slightly out of step with each other. It's as if somewhere in our heads we hear music, but the melody isn't the same. Or maybe it's that we both want to lead. Or follow. I felt guilty about this all through my high school years. Like there was something lacking in me that made Mother disapprove of me. Finally, the year I graduated and went off to college, I gave up trying to understand her. I stopped asking her opinion of things and accepted the fact that we just didn't have anything in common. She was the quintessential homemaker. Not to denigrate her chosen field, mind you, but I could never see myself doing the June Cleaver thing. I grew up telling Daddy I was going to come to work with him someday, and I didn't change my mind. After high school graduation, I headed for business school. Business school led to graduate school, which landed me my MBA, and the right to work beside my father. The happiest moment of my life was the moment I walked toward my new office at Davis Enterprises and saw my name on the door. Mother sent flowers. Daddy took me to lunch. Working for Davis Enterprises was everything I'd imagined. Except for one thing. 2 years after I received my MBA, Daddy was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. He did his best to teach me everything he knew in a few weeks, and then went home to die. I'm still not very happy with him for giving up so quickly. I spent hours on the internet investigating alternative therapies and treatments, but Daddy said no, he wanted to be at home with Mother. He didn't want to travel, he said. I've always suspected that what was really going on was Mother didn't want to travel. She's never been one to stray far from home. It seems like she could have gotten past that for Daddy's sake. Maybe he could have lived a little longer. I don't know what would have happened to us during those hellish days when Daddy was dying if it hadn't been for Jeff. We met at a business conference I didn't want to go to and almost skipped out of. I'm glad I didn't. We were already engaged when Daddy was diagnosed, and it means a lot to me to know that my father approved of Jeff. Jeff fills in all the gaps in my breach with my mother. His own mom died of cancer, so Jeff understands what it's like to lose a parent that way. And he reminds me to appreciate having Mother around, whether I understand her or not. I thought Daddy's dying would bring Mother and me closer together. It hasn't. The things about her I don't understand just keep multiplying. I hurt just as much as she does, but a person can't just come to a grinding halt when they lose someone they love. Daddy told us both. He expected us to keep living. I never thought my mother and dad had any great, deep love affair going. But maybe I was wrong, because since Daddy's been gone, Mother seems to be losing her grip on life. She doesn't get out unless you count going to lunch at Val's. She never invites people in unless it's something I've planned for the foundation. When I suggest she needs a social life, she just gives me the look that says, I don't understand. Which, truth be told, I don't. I know that as a widow, she's the odd number at a dinner party. But if she'd give half the energy to becoming an interesting person that she gives to wandering aimlessly around the old market or poking through antique shops, it wouldn't matter if she was part of a couple or not. If it weren't for me insisting that she do things for the foundation from time to time, I don't know if she'd even bother to get dressed some mornings. Even Irene is worried. People think she's just the housekeeper, but she's a lot more than that. Irene and Cecil Baxter have lived in the cottage just behind the main house for as long as I can remember. Cecil takes care of the grounds and the cars. Irene takes care of the meals and the house. Most of the time, they treat all of us more like their surrogate children than their employers. It used to irritate Daddy to the point that he once threatened to replace them. I didn't think Irene knew about that, but the next day she baked two pies, rhubarb and gooseberry, and 3 dozen kolaches. Daddy never again objected to Irene treating us all like family. And Irene went out of her way to address Daddy as Sir and Mother as Ma'am in the presence of outsiders. She even acquiesced to Daddy's request that she wear a uniform for company. Irene says Mother just needs time. But after this morning's display at the foundation meeting, I'm beginning to think she needs therapy. She isn't herself, that's for sure. I want her to take an interest in things, and that would naturally include the foundation. But it just isn't like her to pick a fight in front of the committee like that. Of course I regret hurting her feelings, but I'm grieving too. The oncology wing for the hospital is important to me, and I don't want it ruined. George Kincaid was a great architect. Once, but his best days are long gone. Daddy would have realized that. I don't know what Mother was talking about, saying that he would have championed George's comeback. The Samuel Davis I knew wasn't a man to risk important ventures on weaklings. And for Mother to contradict me in front of the committee, well, that was just bad form. Again, Daddy would never have done that. And no one would ever have attempted it with him either. I'm beginning to think I made a mistake when I tried to get Mother more involved. Clearly, she's misunderstood what I had in mind. It's a good thing she's invited Jeff and me to dinner tonight. I don't know what's going on with her, but I'm going to find out. And we're going to clear the air about this George Kincaid business, too. Chapter 4. Mother, you are kidding, right? Liz stifled a laugh and looked across the dining table at Jeffrey, her blue eyes sending an unspoken message. Jeff looked down at his plate, inspecting his steak like a biologist examining a petri dish. Mary was reminded of the way Liz and Sam used to relay unspoken messages to one another across the dinner table. She spoke to Jeff. "That's a new sauce I asked Irene to try out." She looked at Liz and smiled. "And no, I'm not kidding. My passport came yesterday, and I'm ready to book the flight." Apparently Jeff's radar was on a different setting than Sam's had been. After taking a bite of steak and sounding his approval, he winked at Mary and said, "You go, girl." "I thought you said you were going to get more involved in the foundation," Liz said, frowning. "Running off to Paris and missing the holiday gala doesn't sound like getting more involved to me." "Were we at the same meeting today?" Mary asked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.